With the release of 3ds Max 2018.2 update, you'll find a new Spline Morph modifier that does to splines what the Morpher modifier does to geometry. Open the scene named f1logostart.max. It shows the end result of another lesson on this channel about using the Path to Form modifier. Let's make this animation more interesting. What if, in addition to the animated sweep, the actual paths were to change shape? Start by hiding the two sweeping boxes in the Scene Explorer. You only need to concentrate on the paths in this case. Both are simple lines with only a handful of vertices, 4 and 5 respectively. The goal here is to create an effect where the F1 letters turn into the silhouette of a racing car. For that, you'll need two additional shapes that define the car silhouette. Draw them in the front view, starting with simple shapes, and then editing them at a sub-object level. If you'd rather skip this step, you can also merge the file carlines.max provided to you with this lesson. A download link is available in the description section of this movie. So now you have the splines in place, but because of how they were each created, they do not necessarily have the same number of vertices or knots. Line 1 has only 4 vertices, and if it were to morph into line 3, it needs to have the same number of vertices as the target. This is not the case right now, as line 3 currently has 10 vertices. Apply a normalized spline modifier to line 3, set it to show knots, and use the knot count option. Currently, it messes up the original shape quite heavily. Increase the number of knot count until the silhouette looks right to you. 80 knots should be quite adequate. To copy this modifier and all its parameters onto line 1, use a simple click and drag. Note how, although the original knot count is different between the two shapes, the new knot count is now very much the same. Repeat the procedure for the other spline pair. Note that while spline pairs need the same knot count, in this case you can use a smaller number for the second pair, as the target shape is simpler. A knot count of about 40 should be more than enough. Select line 1 and apply a spline morph modifier. The interface is easy to understand, as you can pick targets using the appropriate buttons. In this case, you can pick line 3 as a target, but other shapes in the scene are unavailable because they have a different knot count. That's okay, as we set ourselves to use spline pairs and only line 3 is meant to be the target of line 1. The original line changes into a shape that's a mix of the original and the target. This is because the morph amount is set to 50% by default. Change the amount to see the effect you're about to animate. Set it to 0 when you're ready. For the first 100 frames or so, we want the letter F to stay in place and then only start morphing after frame 100. Enable Auto Key and go to frame 160. Change the morph amount from 0 to 100. This applies the morphing between frames 0 and 160. To constrain it between 100 and 160, simply slide the first keyframe from 0 to 100. Scrub or play back the animation to see the effect. Before you tackle the second spline pair, unhide box 1 that sweeps along the path. Select the box and note that the stretch value is animated between frames 0 and 80 to accommodate the F in F1. But now that the spline is morphing into a greater distance, the stretch of the box falls short. With Auto Key enabled, you will need to add a couple more stretch value keyframes at 100 and 160. disable auto key when done. You probably need to increase the iterations of the Turbo Smooth modifier applied to the box. Repeat the procedure for the other spline pair to animate the morph between frames 100 and 160. In this case, we'll also need to relocate the spline by animating its position between frames 100 and 160. If you end up with a cross-section that you judge too large or too small, then you can adjust it without actually editing the base object. Simply adjust the scale value in the driven scale rollout. In this case, you can scale the cross-section by half by setting the 0.5 value. You can, in fact, get really creative and set different scale factors along the path. Open the Scale Curve Editor, and you'll see a window reminiscent of the old loft deformation techniques. Here, you can define different scale factors for the cross-section, such as smaller at the beginning and larger towards the end. The fun starts when you add control points to the curve and start editing that curve to your liking. Take a moment and experiment with the scale curves, and keep in mind you can do the same with rotation curves to induce rotation and twists. Also keep in mind that when you normalize a spline, you reset the segment IDs so that an object relying on that will now have the same material applied. You may need to add another edit spline at the top of the stack to redefine the segment IDs. One final word of caution. If you render an object deforming along a path while acquiring material IDs from the underlying spline, you may get an unwanted flickering effect as the polygons on the deforming object change colors as they cross the material ID threshold. To minimize that effect, try increasing the level of detail on the object. Be aware that this increases poly count and render time. The morphing effect you created here was simple in a way, as each baseline morphed into one target. It can get more interesting when a shape has to morph into multiple targets, such as when creating a countdown effect. Let's see how we can create such an effect. Reset your scene. We'll be counting down from the number 5, just like in the sample animation. To create a spline in the shape of a number 5, you can certainly use the line tool and then edit vertices and edges. Better yet, you can start with a text object to extract the shape that you need. You'll still need to work at a sub-object level. The idea is to end up with a single line representing the number 5. Take a moment to create the 5 digits and do not worry about the vertex count. If you'd rather skip this step, you can merge these numbers from the file named numbers.max that you downloaded for this lesson. A download link is available in the description section of this movie. Move the number 5 to the center of the world at 000. As you can imagine, these letters do not have the same vertex knot count. Number 5 has 12 knots, whereas number 1 has only 4. So the first order of business is to normalize all splines to have the same knot count number as you did earlier in the lesson. I'll set the knot count value to 100 for this lesson. At this point, you can add the Spline Morph modifier to the stack. With the targets adjusted for detail, you can load the morph targets in their appropriate channels. Load them in the sequence you want them to appear, namely 4, 3, 2, and 1. When you have multiple morph targets, you have two methods of morphing between them. One is called a blended mode, where you can define individual percentages between the morph targets. This is similar to the default settings of the Morpher modifier when applied to geometry. When morphing needs to cycle through morph targets in a specific way, as is the case for a countdown, for example, then it's easier to use a progressive morph. In this case, an amount percentage value takes you from one target to the next. Here, we have an original shape plus 4 targets. When the amount percent value is at 0, you see the original shape. Between 0 and 25%, you morph from the original shape to the first target, in this case number 4. From 25 to 50%, you morph between the first and second targets, taking you from 4 to 3, and so on. If the number of morph targets is different, then so is the percentage cutoff. With 4 targets, an amount of 25% takes you from one target to the next. 100 over 4 equals 25. With 5 targets, the percentage amount would be 20%. 100 over 5 equals 20, and so on. So all that remains is to animate the morph amount percent over time. Set the amount percent value to 0 as a starting point. Make sure you are at frame 0 and that you have at least 300 frames to work with. You may find that the set key animation method is easier to work with in this scenario. Set the key filters to modifiers only, as the amount percent is the only value you need to animate, and enable set key. You'll be animating the morph every 30 frames or so. Go to frame 30 and hit the set keys button or press K to create a keyframe. This prevents any morphing from happening before that frame. Go to frame 60 and change the morph value to 25% to change the 5 into a 4, and then create a key. Go to frame 90 and create another key, cementing an unchanged number 4 between frames 60 and 90. At frame 120, set the amount to 50% to morph into the number 3 and create a key. You can see a pattern developing here, where morphing happens for 30 frames and then the number staying still for another 30. Continue building the animation that way. And disable set key when done. Play back the animation to see the results. If you have been wondering how the sample animation shown in this lesson was created, it is using the same technique you have followed this far. You can learn more about it by analyzing the file named 12345morph.max that you downloaded for this lesson. What was added to the workflow that you already learned about is a simple cylinder that was path deformed on the morphing spline. It is using an auto stretch option to adapt to the various spline's length. The cylinder was made non-renderable as its purpose is to be used as a particle emitter. Objects to be used as particles were created in the form of varied numbers and a few small spheres and combined into a group. A standard particle flow was created. You can see its diagram by pressing 6. It's a simple P-flow system where the particle's birth is set to start and end at frame 0, meaning the same particles remain on screen the whole time. A position object operator was used to conform particle positions on the surface of the deformed cylinder. Speed was set to 0, as the particles didn't need to travel, only rotate and spin. Rotation and spin operators were added to that very effect. Finally, a shape instance operator was used to have particles display the various elements of the numbers group. All this gives a nice little motion graphics project to create a countdown effect.